Test Tank 17 is finally rolled out to masses. Launch mount rolls out of Sanchez, and the cranes are getting prepared for its lift at the launch site. Hey everyone, and welcome to RGV Aerial Photography's Starbase Flyover update number 83. The weather on May 9th was perfect for another fantastic flyover up to an altitude of 10,500 feet. The flight captured all the developments here at Starbase Texas. My name is Jeff A, and I'll be your guide today, so let's kick back and take in all the exciting sights. Here's a map of the site made by Proky to help you find your way around. Beginning at the booster cryo stand, all of the mounts of the inner 13 engine pistons have been installed, as well as most of the clamp arm mounts around the outside. This incredible close-up, thanks to the new camera lens, shows how the center ridge of the flame bucket deluge system will miss all the engines. While there are no engine testing rams for the outer 20 engines on this stand, their placement will align with the steel uprights under the platform surrounding the stand. At the BQD platform, walkways are being installed with further materials staged nearby. Moving to the flame trench gantry, we can see a new high pressure line has been installed. This line originates from the high pressure tanks and is unclear what it's used for. At the structural test stand, new curved pieces of steel have been added. These are used to help stabilize the clamp arms when they introduce torsional forces to the test article in the cage. Looking even closer around the thrust sim rams, additional horizontal rams can be seen. These will simulate the side forces on the center mounts created by engine gimballing. The ship cryo test stand has a similar system. There is a single ram mounted a little higher on a vertical I-beam. Behind the rig, work on the crusher cap includes the 20 blue pull-down rods getting a fresh coat of paint and the addition of hydraulic lines for the 6 torsion rams that will twist the cap. Test Tank 17 rolled here to masses in the early hours of the 10th of May. In this close-up from Sean Giesler, we can see the adapters that will connect the push rods to the twin sets of rams in the test stand. Before we move to Sanchez, let's check in on Rio West and the tiny home lot next to Highway 4. Starting at the apartment buildings, we can see the staircases are coming along nicely so residents can access the roof. Moving to the right, the framing of the housing in the middle is progressing well, as well as foundations and concrete for additional garages taking shape. At the top and bottom, the framing and second level temporary framework and concrete is slowly progressing. Moving on, curbs and roadways have been poured, and rebar has been laid for the next section to be poured in the coming week. Finally, at the tiny home site near Highway 4, groundwork continues with geotextile being used to stabilize the soil, as well as some new electrical work near the entrance of the site. Let's move on to Sanchez, shall we? Starting at the now former OLM area, the launch mount was moved to the pad on May 7th. This is the heaviest transport that has taken place at Starbase so far. In this area, two new parts were delivered and staged where the OLM had been sitting. They appear to be the sections of the booster QDs. Closer to Highway 4, the hold-down arm actuators were installed on the new booster transport stand. They connect to the clamp arms to move for extension and retraction. We see some progress on the speculated stand, likely for ship engine installation, with the main flat section complete. At the crane yard, Test Tank 17 is ready to be moved to masses ahead of heavy-duty structural testing to verify the aft section designed for version 3 boosters. It would move to masses the next day on the 10th and lifted into the test cage on the 12th. Now, at the scrapyard, a Pathfinder barrel was moved from Star Factory to be scrapped. It has a new ship QD plate and 2 docking ports. The main speculation is this is a test barrel for future ships with orbital refueling capabilities. Finally, the water plumbing and drainage work continues through Remedios Avenue. Just before moving to the build site, we'd like to thank all our YouTube and Patreon members. Keep in mind, all of the patrons get to participate in our show and tell sessions on the same day of each flight. You can join in the discussions and ask your own questions. YouTube members also get to watch and listen in with a live chat function. Starting off at the wedge section of the Star Factory, most of the windows were removed and the wedge was finally pulled down on May the 11th. High Bay has been further deconstructed. The day following this flyover, Ship 35 was once again loaded onto the static fire stand and rolled out to masses. The next day on the 11th, the tanks were loaded with propellant and the water deluge was activated, but the ship failed to ignite its engines. A second attempt was made on the 12th, this time resulting in a full 60 second static fire of all 6 engines, with the RVAC shutting down nominally a few seconds before the centre engines. Once complete, it was time for the ship to head back to the build site in the early hours of May the 13th. Earlier that night on the 12th, Booster 14 was also rolled out, but this time to the launch site, and lifted onto the OLM at Pad A at around 4:30am on the 13th. This will be in preparation for Flight 9, scheduled for no earlier than May the 21st. Looking closely at this image, we can see that the crane named Shadow working on updating the left turntable that the booster aft sections are stacked on. Over in Mega Bay 2, Ship 38 has its common dome section stacked, while Ships 36 and 37 remain on the workstands. Looking around the village, we can see steady progress on the Meme Street apartments, as well as continued roadworks and accommodation construction. The area next to the pool has been further cleared, with some new landscaping nearby. With that, let's head on over to the launch site. Here's an updated map of the launch site with labels. A couple of new things have arrived, including the launch mount for Pad B. Let's begin this week with some tight shots of the launch mount. As expected, three SPMTs were used to transport it. Inside the ring, the four clamp arms are extended and will be used as the attachment points for the rigging to the cranes. Zooming in, we can see a lifting plate has been installed to each arm through the largest hole near the clamp location. Moving to the flame trench, both LR11000 cranes are being prepared for the lift. The Stinger and counterweight tray for the SpaceX crane has been readied, as has the pad for the Buckner counterweight. Both cranes have their rigging suspended from their hook blocks. Final groundwork is being placed for the launch mount to be moved in front of the cranes. On May 11th, the cranes performed a lift test of the mount ahead of the final lift over the trench, which took place on the morning of May 12th. Work continues on the trench walls. The final slope wall is not matching the three filled with concrete last week. On the easternmost exit of the trench, additional wall panels are installed next to the trench legs with an angle that matches the gantry buttress beam. It appears that this may be the final shape of the walls. Turning to the other side, the panels of the western angle are staged for installation. In the centre wall sections, concrete has been poured inside the panels ahead of the installation of the mount. This week, the space between the walls and sheet pile next to the tower have also been filled. Behind the gantry, a new excavation is seen. A highly reinforced pad with what might be three cast-in-place electrical vaults has been formed. Moving around the site, a new concrete pad has rapidly appeared. This area is planned to be the site for a future air separation unit. It's unclear if this is related to that facility or just the beginning of covering the entire site in concrete. Behind the tower, the high pressure gas lines are being extended from the precast culvert that was installed in the base several months ago. Moving over to the deluge farm, the BG42 drilling rig has begun work in the area. Some piles can be seen behind the drill in a straight line. This could be for a planned blast wall. On the other side of these tanks, two excavations have been dug. It's unclear though what this space is for. To the side of the tanks, most of the pipe assemblies for continued deluge systems are organised and staged for when excavation work can resume after launch mount installation. At the Pad B pump farm, steady progress can be seen. The line of LOX pumps has increased by one, with an additional pump installed in position 7 and a motor installed in pump 6. The methane line of pumps appear to have all 8 sumps installed, with the first 5 pumps also installed. Two of the motors for these pumps have been delivered near the Pad A deluge farm. A bit further back, a pipe system leading to the propellant trench continue integration. Along the pipe rack adjacent to the blast wall, two larger pipes have been lifted into place. These appear to be methane supplies to the booster and ship. Along the last horizontal tank, a large diameter pipe is being assembled on the ground. The size of this pipe matches the main supply of methane being installed along the front of the tank farm. Looking along the front of the tank farm, the pipe assemblies being fabricated are now being lifted to the top level of the pipe rack. The larger pipe now appears mostly in place, with a smaller pipe joining in on the east end of the racks. The vaporizer seen last week is now in place, though not on one of the three fan pedestals. Pipe fitters continue to use the space within the original tank farm for assembly of new pipes. Some of these with S-bends in them match assemblies used for each of the tanker offload stations at the front of the farm. At the far end, near the Pad A comms bunker, three additional fan pedestals are staged. These arrived prior to the last flyover, but it's unclear where they will be installed. Let's take one final look at the construction of the roundabout. The centre has been completed and the painted lines which mark the traffic lanes have been finished, making it fully operational. Moving to pad A, activity is once again hard to see, which indicates that the pad is ready for the next test flight. The mount is yet to see a fresh coat of paint, suggesting just like flight 8, flight 9 will not see a freshly painted OLM. Any remaining work on the booster holddown clamps and Raptor QDs appear complete, as well as the scaffolding assembled on the dance floor broken down and ready to be lifted out. With the rains leading up to the flyover, the retention ponds are holding water. The larger is very full, and while normally we see many MOVAC trucks drain the pond for treatment, a large trailer mounted pump has recently arrived. It's unknown where they will pump the water to, but a hose has been run around the launch site perimeter, stopping near the Pad B launch mount during the flyover. Well, that's it for episode 83 of Starbase Flyover Update. Thank you for choosing to fly with RGV Aerial Photography, and we hope you all enjoyed the flight. If you liked what you saw today, please subscribe for more episodes and content so you don't miss out on the new videos each week. I'm Jeff A, and we hope to see you again from 10,500 feet.